I remember when I was applying to medical school and the interviewer asked me, I want to investigate the color yellow in butterfly wings. Would I fund it? And I said, well, I don't see the application of that, so I probably wouldn't have funded it. And he said, well, you know, studying the color yellow in butterfly wings gave us one of the leading cancer and autoimmune therapeutics.
You have to be curious. 40 years ago, people who cared about coronavirus, you know, and how good that those people went on and investigated. You don't know, you set it out what to investigate.
So when I came to Penn, I was interested in making vaccines using dendritic cells that I had studied. And that's when I met Katie over a photocopy machine.
And it was 1998 when he arrived to Penn. And he mentioned that he was coming from Anthony Fauci's laboratory. Didn't ring a bell. This was a long time ago, and Anthony Fauci was not in the television set. Messenger RNA was discovered in 1961. People usually did not see that this RNA can be useful for anything. So I was insisting and persisting because every time we could see improvement.
Katie came to me with RNA. I came to her with the immune system, and it was really like chocolate and peanut butter coming together and making a Reese's cup, and it formed an enormous collaboration.
You will see our personality is very different because I am very bubbling and he's quiet and considerate.
We have completely opposite personalities. Each of us taught each other what they knew, and I think that was what was critical. DNA represents our genetic code. Every single protein, every single sequence that makes our bodies work. RNA is the intermediate. So in order for a cell to make a protein, an RNA makes a copy of a protein in the DNA. It's essentially taking one page out of a journal, photocopying it, and then using it for something.
And he realized that the mRNA is actually inducing inflammatory molecules. And I was worried about that I would make more harm.
Every week, every month, we would have new results that just surprised us, that we couldn't explain, we didn't understand. And then we spent years figuring out how RNA activates a dendritic cell. And that finally led us to figure out how to make the RNA non-inflammatory. And that's how we developed nucleoside-modified mRNA. It's now being used in the first two approved COVID-19 vaccines.
Drew predicted that we will be invited to give talks and that. And did not happen. Sometimes, you know, they don't want to change and use something, a different method.
The research that Katie and I did all along was considered superfluous. People just had little to no interest in it. We didn't give up. We saw the potential of it. We saw that it had enormous future impact, and we were luckily right.
Eventually, other scientists did and tried it, and they were successful. And then their publication had drew attention to our publication.
That's life. I mean, you never know where science is going to take you. You never know, is this experiment going to work? You have to have confidence that what you're studying is important, that it has the potential to be critically important. And then you have to persevere and you have to stick with it.
Here's the most surprising part of the entire experience. There is no one on the planet that has all of the code that goes in an automobile.
Your car company these days is just an integrator putting together all these parts from different manufacturers. It absolutely creates a security problem.
It starts in late 2007, and Yoshi had been working on some really neat work.
I think what has prepared me most for working in automotive security is all the work that I've done looking at security for other emerging technologies.
And I said, hey, I bet there are similar kinds of security issues in all of these other kinds of devices.
And automobiles were definitely one of those.
So I think it was Stefan who cornered us, asked us, hey, are you interested in trying to hack a car? And we're like, sure.
So the team at the University of Washington were PhD students at the time, Carl Kosher, Alexei Cheskis, Francisco Rossner. As a team, we called Carl the car whisperer.
On the San Diego side, Brian Cantor, Danny Anderson, Damon McCoy, and then Steve Checkaway.
Stefan approached me. His pitch was, let's buy a car and see what functionality in the car we can control.
To my memory, no one in the team knew anything specific about cars prior to us starting.
I grew up in New York City. I learned to drive when I was 28.
And that involved a lot of research and figuring out, like, okay, what is under computer control?
So modern cars are almost completely computer controlled. Everything from the door locks to the steering to the brakes.
But they need to talk to each other because when you are hitting the brakes, the stability control unit needs to know that you're hitting the brakes and the engine controller needs to know. And rather than draw wires between all of them, they started building networks in the cars that connected everything to each other.
We landed on what was probably one of the most computerized cars at the time.
They were 2009 Chevy Impalas. So our car was called Vlad the Impala. There may have been a name for the UW car, I don't remember.
We couldn't top that name, so we just settled on Emma.
First, there was a period in learning about automotive electronics and the history of it.
We ordered the dealer service manual. It's about, you know, this tall.
We noticed really early on just how many messages were being sent back and forth between the computers.
And so what we did in the beginning, because we really did not understand very much, is we just plugged in and looked at the messages.
And we listened. And we did things like we pressed the brake pedal and we saw what message was sent. And we turned on the lights and saw what message was sent. And over the course of that process, we were able to learn the language that the car spoke. And then we started to develop the ability to speak that language ourselves.
The CD exploit was actually one of the things that took us the longest to figure out.
We could take a normal piece of digital music,
Beethoven's Symphony No. 9,
change it slightly. It'll still play fine on your laptop, but if you ever took that song and played it in our car, it would take over the car.
One of the other ways that we could get into the car was through OnStar service.
It turns out that our car has an internal cell phone.
We were able to call the phone in the car from anywhere in the world and play a specially crafted sequence of tones.
That sounds kind of like a fax machine on steroids, you know.
And then from there, take control of the entire rest of the car.
So one of the absolutely critical parts of this research was to understand and experiment with the vehicle in actually real driving situations.
My first idea was using the I-5 express lanes here, which are closed overnight. But it turned out it was easier to acquire use of a decommissioned airport. They still had the runway there.
Alexei Cheskis, one of the students at the University of Washington, volunteered to drive the car for these experiments.
Decked out in his motorcycle safety gear.
He was eager, because I think we would not have asked anyone to do it. There were a lot of lawyers involved.
We had a number of safety precautions in place.
Like fallback things to disable the vehicle if something went awry. The police escort, the whole nine yards.
Other team members were driving along beside him in a different car.
I had my own laptop, which was connected over Wi-Fi to the laptop in the car to sort of simulate a remote attacker.
The brakes would get turned off, or the brakes would get turned on, and we would make him skid.
It was kind of Mythbusters-y.
When we first demonstrated this for the folks from GM, we had the car outside the window. We call the car, and then all of a sudden the car outside starts honking its horn, and the windshield wipers are going, and the fluid is shooting off, and they were convinced that there was an issue.
GM started a whole product security organization, and we're hiring people like crazy to actually develop cybersecurity.
The car that we used was a GM car, but it was absolutely not a GM problem. The way the whole automotive industry supply chain worked, that was shared by all the manufacturers.
And our goal was to help make the world a better place.
And I think that the work that we did, while it had the largest impact in the automotive industry, actually definitely was a wake-up call for a number of other industries as well.
I would actually make a call for the research community to think about what are the other technologies that are incredibly integrated into our lives, but they have not received the security analysis that we gave these automobiles, and to think about what the risks might be with those technologies and how we can proactively secure those technologies as well so that they don't become a risk in the future.
My careers master, Mr. Baskerby, said, Craig Jordan is an unusual young man.
I saw that he was a unique individual.
Capital letters, a very unusual young man.
He really understands the potential in people where other people don't.
They said we had to learn what that meant. The rest is history. My name is Dr. V. Craig Jordan. I'm the living legend professor at the MD Anderson Cancer Center. Most of the ground was laid when I was at grammar school before the age of 18. After my father had bought me a chemistry set one Christmas, I decided I wanted to convert my bedroom into a real chemistry laboratory. Now I wanted to learn more and more chemistry. It was as easy as that. I focused all my career over the last 40 years in the discovery that we can use failed contraceptives that were available, but they weren't going anywhere. And I wanted to turn them into anti-cancer agents for the treatment and prevention of breast cancer. How bad was it? They couldn't find anybody in the whole country who would be willing to examine my PhD because it was useless. One person, Dr. Arthur Walpole, at a pharmaceutical company with a failed contraceptive that became tamoxifen that they didn't know what to do with, agreed to be my examiner. The discovery of what became SERMs, selective estrogen receptor modulators, all happened by accident. We did an experiment because a man came from another department and he said, we know estrogen is good for bones, but I want you to develop a model for me in rats of using anti-estrogens that makes bones rot away. And we treated them with tamoxifen, but we did the first experiment. So he treated the animals for 3 months, gave me the results, and I said, are you sure you've not mixed up all of these groups? This can't be true. Tamoxifen maintained bone density just like estrogen. One compound can maintain bone density, decrease heart attacks, prevent osteoporosis, decrease breast cancer, stop it nearly dead in its tracks. So scientifically, we have been given the credit for that with prizes around the world.
The environment in Dr. Jordan's lab was actually very exciting because we were doing groundbreaking work in those days.
Tamoxifen team is a family. So you can go to all of the people in the tamoxifen team. I have a newsletter and I put that out probably every other month and send it around to probably the 50 or 60 people that are part of this group.
I was lucky because Dr. Jordan realized my potential and saw that I could be a great scientist.
My mentor, the Nobel laureate Sir James Black, said to me, invest in the young. That was his most important thing. That's what I do. I invest in the young by investing in making sure they get the best degrees that they can.
I've had a lot of mentors during my career, but Dr. Jordan really stands above all the others because he really has made me what I am today. What I learned from Dr. Jordan is to really realize that serendipity that occurs, that when experiments don't occur the way you think that they're going to do, that That's where the real discoveries come.
Serendipity. If I hadn't been asked to make this new model of osteoporosis, we wouldn't have any of this. If I'd have stayed in Britain, we wouldn't have any of this. So there's some magic hand guiding all of this. We may call it God or fate or serendipity.